Welcome to HG Designs Crochet, HGDC. I'm Heather, the designer of granny square patterns for my tribe. I went from corporate lawyer being told what to do to full-time self-employed crochet designer doing what pleases my soul. Now, I also champion yarny creatives just like you to build income streams from your passion. Join me on my mission to change the world one crochet pattern at a time. Hey tribe, welcome back to HG Designs Crochet, HGDC. I'm Heather and this is my channel all about the granny square. Shock, I've got some in my hand. And it's also for the new and aspiring crochet designer. If you are brand new, hi, hello and welcome to the tribe. I am so happy to have you here. And if you're returning, hey tribe, what's good, what's happening? Hope that you're all a tickety boo. I have a vlog for you today. It's a question and answer. So about a week or 2 weeks ago, I had a bit of time. And so I put on Instagram an ask me anything, question and answer type thing. And I got quite a few responses and I meant to then post the responses on my Instagram. However, time, blah, 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 things happened. And fast forward to now, and it's the 11th of April, and I needed to record a vlog, and so I figured I would answer all of the questions because you can put a bit more information into a video as opposed to a couple of Instagram stories. So whilst I do that, I'm going to work on some squares. I'm making these two round granny squares. I'm using a 4.5mm crochet hook, and I've just picked up a selection of yarns out of my tub and I'm just gonna dive in and make a load of them. I'm gonna start off by making a load of centers and then I'll put the second round on. So for example here I made a load that had burgundy centers and then I put the second round on, and then I made a load of pink and I put the second round on. I'm gonna do the same thing. I think I'm gonna jump in with this green and probably make like five or so centers, and then yeah, let's just do it, shall we? These squares are going into a granny square project. Obviously, a granny square project that I am planning on making. I wanted to make a baby-sized granny square blanket for baby Taylor, because I've made a giant one. So it's much bigger so that when they are a small adult, tiny human, it will still cover them. But I wanted something that I could use when they're like in their car seat and things like that. Little disclaimer, because I feel like I have to keep giving them out. I am well aware that crochet, because it creates a fabric that has holes in it, little fingers can get wrapped around the stitches and it can cause them to lose their circulation to their fingers. So you need to supervise children when they're with crochet. Please use your own discretion, your own judgment, whether that's something you're comfortable doing. I have also had people say to me though that crochet is more breathable, so they felt more comfortable using that on their children. So whatever works for you. I adore granny squares and I will be using them around my child. I'm gonna have to keep pausing to count. Don't know if I'm gonna edit them out or make you sit through my counting. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So, as I said, I put up a load of questions. I put up a box and I got a load of questions and some of them are very varied. So I am going to run through them now. There's just 11 questions. We'll see how many of them we get done. I'm gonna give myself about 30 minutes and also see how many of these we can make. So first things first. First question on my list is, do you have a favorite granny square color combination? Which I thought was a pretty good question. The answer is I have a favourite in that I like the scrap granny look. So I like to just grab loads of different colours, make loads of granny squares and then join them in black. And that's like my trademark. I think that's what I'm most known for. I'm known for the granny squares, but mine are usually scrap granny squares. I have made a couple of projects where the granny squares are all matchy matchy, but it's not really my go-to. Maybe I should have made a load of centres and then I could put the second round on and there'd be less counting. Oh yeah. Right, so there's not a lot of pauses of me counting the centres and or lots of me having to edit me out. I'm taking out a load of the centres that are in this tub and I'm going to add the second round because I don't need to keep pausing to count to do that. What I tend to do is I'll grab a load of colours, make a load of centres, and then I will add the second round, which is why I've got loads of repeats of the same one. So now I will just pick out the colours and add the second round on. And let's continue with the questions. Okay, thank you. Oh, I'm so annoyed at that. Oh, we're just going to bin that colour off for now. Nope, not got time for that. So as I was saying, I prefer, my favourite combination for granny squares is two round granny squares, stash busting, so I'll just grab whatever colour combos and put them together and then I join them in black. I really like joining them in black glitter as well. And that's what I did for this blanket here. This is a larger blanket that I'm in the process of making for baby Taylor. I've put it all together and it just needs the ends weaving in, and then I'm going to try and back it with a fluffy blanket, which is why I've paused it at the moment. But this is just my favourite. So all these different colours all just smooshed together with black glitter yarn, and it's just such a stunning combination. So that's my favourite combo. Done that one. Okay, next question. When did you start crocheting? I learned to crochet when I was 21, so that was 11 years ago now. My nanny taught me how to crochet. I'd fractured my wrist and I wanted to crochet as a form of physiotherapy to get the movement back in my wrist. It was my right hand, I'm right-handed. And I needed to be able to build the strength back up because I had a lot of exams coming up. I was studying law at university and the exams are like 3 hours long. I needed to be able to write lots and lots and lots, and my wrist wasn't quite up to it. So I asked my nanny to teach me how to crochet. I don't know where I got the idea that it was good for wrist physio, but there we go. And she came over on Boxing Day 1 year and taught me how to do chain stitch and then a granny square. I might even have then visited her, or she ended up coming back like the next day for a follow-up lesson. But I kid you not, I was absolutely mesmerized with it. It's like the best thing ever. I'd never really taken an interest before. I think because my nanny is mainly a knitter and she always knitted really complex Aran stuff, it was quite intimidating even to watch it. And I'd never really taken a huge interest, and I didn't spend a huge amount of time with her as I was growing up anyway. And so I just, it just never really could do me. And then I decided that I was going to do it to help my wrist. And I kid you not, that night I went to bed and I was like dreaming. In my sleep, I was crocheting. Like, it must have been a dream, but I vividly remember that whilst I was sleeping, I was going over like how you need to be crocheting. Really weird. And the next day, like, I'd picked up quite a bit of speed, And my nanny said to me, were you doing this in your sleep? And I was like, well, yeah, now you mention it, I was. And so then what I started to do was, because I had a lot of studying to do, I would set a timer of like 20 to 30 minutes. I'd get loads of studying done, and then I'd set another timer and I'd have a break, and I would do 5 to 10 minutes of crochet, which is where the love for the 2 to 3 round granny square started, because I would set a timer and then I'd see how many I could get done in that time. So I actually, the first project I decided to make was an absolutely huge granny square blanket, and I just collected all these odds and ends of yarn, just random scrap yarn, from charity shops, some that my nanny gave to me, some that came with like magazines, freebies, all sorts of random yarn, and started making a huge 2 round granny square blanket. The only thing is, I didn't understand how you wove the ends in, and I didn't weave them in properly. And so I joined this huge blanket and the granny squares just started disintegrating under the weight of themselves. So I pulled it all apart. I managed to save some of the granny squares, but not all of them. And I just like, I wanted to remake it, but it really put me off doing it. So I actually abandoned that. And now I feel like I've come full circle and I'm finally making that sort of blanket again. So I'm making one for baby and I want to make one for Brad and I. I think most people start out with a granny square when it comes to crochet. And then I was also asked, when did you start crocheting and when did you start designing? So in terms of designing, pretty much from day one, because I designed that blanket myself, and I made quite a few blankets. That's what I've always really enjoyed making, is blankets. And they were pretty much my own design. I would pick my own colours, I'd pick my own stitch, and then I would do my own combo and make my own blankets. So designing started really, really early on, literally within like days. But if you mean in terms of patterns that I sell, I published my first pattern, I think it was 2020. I'd been designing, because I make so many granny squares, I wanted other things to put those granny squares into. So I decided that I would try and make like granny square clothing. And I actually made myself a jumper. And then because I shared it here on YouTube and Instagram, I had quite a lot of the tribe saying that they wanted the pattern. How could they get hold of it? So then that's when I put my mind to designing patterns in order to sell, which is different to designing for yourself, because when you design for yourself, you just jump in, you make it, you can tweak it as you go along. But when you're designing, especially a garment, that's a whole different ball game. So it probably took me like 8 or 9 years to get to that point. I could have done it a lot sooner. It's something I've always been interested in, but this has always been a hobby. I had a full-time corporate job and I always used crochet as a escape and like a way to relax. So then when you start introducing it as a side hustle or an income stream, it can lose a little bit of the relaxation type, because I now needed to learn new techniques. There was a big learning curve of like, how do I grade a design? So grading means you have your base pattern and then you use standard measurements to calculate how to make your base pattern in all the different sizes, from extra small to like 5 extra large. And I really struggled to find the information that I needed, and information that was affordable and things like that. So in the end, I self-taught myself, basically, from some courses that I paid for, from some resources that were paid for, and a lot of random freebies. But it took a lot of time to find that information, absorb it, apply it. And because quite a bit of it was free, people have all their own different techniques, which is fine. But when you're trying to learn something and things don't quite mesh, it was just difficult. So Had I have had access to that information a lot sooner, and then I could have done that. If I had access to that information sooner, I could have put out patterns a lot sooner in my career. Everything happens for a reason, so I'm not mad about that, but it is what prompted me to create the HGDC Hub, which is the place for new and aspiring crochet designers. And I've actually got a series of workbooks that have got all of the information that I've learned along the way, so that new designers can put out their own patterns. So whether you need to like a basic on how to grade, or if it's about finances, or if it's about launching your pattern, like, I've got workbooks out there. I'm actually writing the finance one at the moment, but I've got three out there, one on grading, one on pattern launch, and they can come as a bundle, or you can get the pattern launch on its own as well. And Instagram, so I've got like 500 different Instagram ideas, so that you've got something to post, and I've got more on the way. So yeah, that's when I started crocheting, when I started designing, when I started designing my own patterns. And I'm back. I had a phone call from my dad. So let's get back to the questions. Knit or crochet, which one do I prefer? I find this one a little bit difficult to answer. Like, I don't think you have to be one or the other, but I totally get that there's like a bit of a rivalry almost out there. Like, some people look down on crochet. Some people think that knitting's more difficult. Me personally, I like them both equally, because they have their own attributes that I prefer. So for example, I love crochet. I love the granny square. I love how mindless it is. I love how quick I am at making them. I like love making granny square everything, obviously. But then I do find that with crochet, there's a few limitations because, oh poop, why does my yarn do this? Because it doesn't make such a dense fabric and things like that, I find that sometimes knitting can be more appropriate for the project that you want to make. And I have done a lot more knitting for Baby Taylor's wardrobe than I have crochet. I don't want to outright say I have a favourite, but I think I will always have a bigger fondness for crochet because it was what I learned first and it's my go-to. But I am really, really enjoying knitting and think that there's a lot there for me to explore in terms of design with knitting as well as crochet, because I haven't actually released any knitting patterns yet. I don't know, what's your favourite? Do you prefer to knit or crochet? Do you see the value of both, or are you like opposed to one of them? Team knit, team crochet, team both, team why choose? Next question, biggest project so far. In terms of size, the biggest project I ever made was the granny square blanket that I took apart. So the first one I ever made, like 10 years ago now, was the size of like a king size bed. It was huge. And it took me a fair bit of time, not a long time, but a fair bit of time. And it's just a shame about the end, but I'm gonna make another one to that size anyway, very, very soon. Maybe a smidge smaller. Big. And I also made a granny square blanket that was 16 rounds, so each square was 16 rounds, but I ended up giving that away because of the memories that were attached to it. I made that during a particularly rough breakup, and I just didn't want it, and I knew I wasn't going to finish it. So during the first lockdown, I actually donated it to somebody who was shielding and was bored and wanted projects. In terms of like complexity, biggest project has got to be my own patterns, because even though some of them are quite small in size, the sheer amount of work that goes into them makes them a pretty big project, from like the design idea to swatching to figuring out the construction, making the sample and grading it, getting the sample photographed, tech edited, tested, and then, you know, like, you've got to write up the pattern and you've got to launch it. That has got to be like biggest projects without a doubt, my own patterns. I got a question about granny squares. Do I chain two or three in the corners? I chain two. So as you can see on this one here, I'm in a corner there, and I've just created a corner for this side. I chain two and then I put in the next lot of three trebles. I think everyone's got their own way of doing it, and the amount of comments I get like, oh, you make your granny squares differently to me, but like, I don't think there's a one size fits all, and everybody has like a slight variation, because we are all taught by, I did actually put a post on Instagram and a lot of people said like, aunties, nannies, parents, YouTube, books, self-taught, we all learn in so many different ways, and there are so many different variations that you can do within granny squares. So I don't think, like, I'm sure there's other people out there that do granny squares the same way as me who didn't learn from me, but also for every person that does it the same way, there's probably like 10 that do it slightly different, and it doesn't matter, as long as you're happy with the way the granny squares turn out, that's the main thing. So I do two chain in the corners, and I find that gives me a really nice sized granny square. I don't do three just because I feel like it then makes the chain loop too big, and I like my squares to look really nice and uniform. Next question. What knitted garments or crochet garments do you have for baby Taylor? I have just recorded two vlogs on this. I've recorded one on finished objects and one on whips. I originally thought I was going to do them all in one vlog, and then I got the end of the finished objects and it was like 40 minutes long, so I split it into two. So I won't show you them all now because that will be out for you to see, but I will let you know that there is quite a collection of footwear, which I've really enjoyed making. There is a onesie or a romper. There is two jumpers. There's a couple of jackets, but I didn't show them just yet. I'm going to show them at a later date. A pair of leggings, did I say that? And mittens and booties. So things I would like to add are cardigans, and I've got a couple of my own designs that I'm hoping to put out there. So that should be another vlog coming to you soon. Another question on baby is potential names. So the names and gender is a surprise. Before we conceived and Brad and I spoke about children, I didn't want to know the gender. So we already picked a boy and a girl name, and we decided to keep them to ourselves until baby is here. And then as the pregnancy progressed, Brad wanted to know the gender. And although I'm the one carrying the child, I'm the one that's in at hospital, yada, 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 I could not have done this without him. I physically wouldn't be pregnant without him. I could not have done this pregnancy without his support. And so because it is very much his pregnancy just as much as mine, I didn't want him to not have the experience he wanted. So we compromised and we found out the gender and we've kept it to ourselves. That's had a really mixed reaction. We've, from people saying I'm cruel because I haven't shared it, because people just feel entitled to the information, to people thinking it's bizarre. But ultimately that's what worked for us. I didn't want to know, but Brad did want to know. And so that way we both got what we wanted. it's helped me because this pregnancy has been difficult. I felt like I've been able to bond with Bump a bit more because I've been really been able to visualize baby being here and like bath time and outfits and things like that. That being said, we are both very minimal in terms of possessions and belongings, and we didn't want to amass a huge amount of stuff for baby. So we intentionally said that even though we know the gender, we're still going to go gender neutral, because should we choose to have another child, we'd like to reuse a lot of the stuff rather than having to go get more. So we've decided not to do gender specific, and by not finding out the gender, it has curbed people's spending quite a bit actually, because obviously everyone's really excited and you go into a shop and there's so much baby stuff there and you just want to pick it up and you want to buy it, but there isn't as much gender neutral stuff. So actually quite a few people have said to us, we wasn't sure what you do and don't need, so here's like a drop of cash to go towards whatever it is that you would like to get, or they've purchased via our Amazon registry. So it means that we've not ended up with like loads of items that you wouldn't necessarily choose yourself. You know, when like somebody turns up and their outfit, like you're genuinely grateful that they thought of you and got that for baby, but you just, it's not your style, it's not your vibe at all. And we've not had any of that because everything's just been very like neutral, everything just vibes because it all goes together. So yeah, the only place that's given us gender specific is when I was admitted to hospital, and one of the midwives went and gathered a big bag of baby clothes and nappies and wipes for me because I was in quite a bad place and she wanted to cheer me up, and they obviously know the gender. So and she said, whatever you don't use, just re-donate to the hospital or donate to a charity. And we have we are part of a church and there's a lot of babies there, so once we've been through all of the stuff and sorted everything out that we're not keeping, then we will probably just pass it on to our church, and then new families can access those clothes instead. So yeah, I'm excited about that. I'll be able to bless another family. Granny Square. I should have showed you them every time I finished one, but I'll show you them all at the end. Baby names are a surprise. Just because I don't really want the input from people. We know what we want to call our child, and it doesn't matter what people say, we're going to pick the name. But everyone always has to put their 2 pence in, don't they? Like, oh, I wouldn't pick that name, or blah, 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 blah. Just no. So the first everyone's going to hear of the name is when it is baby's name. I can say that inspiration has come from grandparents and great grandparents. So, but you don't know my great grandparents' name, so you have no idea. Another question I received is how much yarn is needed to make this pattern. So this is my invested pattern. It is a crochet granny square tank or vest pattern, and all of the information of yardage and things like that for all my patterns are always with the listings. And what I'll do is I'll copy and paste that below for you so it's there, and also I'll put the link to the pattern so you can go and get it. It uses double knit yarn. There are 9 sizes, so I'll put the amounts on there for you so that you can make that pattern. I'm actually running a cal at the moment, the HGDC cal. The hashtag and everything I'll put on the screen now. All you need to do is get a HGDC pattern and start making it and post about it on Instagram using the hashtag and tag me so that I can find you. It's a really simple low-key cal. I ran a sale for Baby Taylor to bridge a gap in my income because I hadn't been able to earn anything. And because there was like 600 odd people that had a pattern, I decided to run the cow because there's a lot of people making granny squares at the moment. So all of that information is below for you. Next question I've received is, how's work and upcoming projects coming along? The short and simple answer is, work has basically been on a pause. So I am a full-time self-employed crochet designer, and I also did some consultancy on the side as well. I am a qualified legal executive, so solicitor, lawyer, whatever term you use in your country. I was doing some of that on a consultancy basis for a firm, a company, and also doing HGDEC, so that had different income streams. And once the sickness of this pregnancy kicked in, I have a condition called hyperemesis. Loads of information on that on my Instagram. I'll link below to charities if you're interested or you need the support. The sickness kicked in on week four, the nausea was week four. The vomiting was week five. The vomiting didn't really get under control until week 26. And there's been quite a few hospital admissions, and at its worst, makes me sad even thinking about it. At its worst, I was being sick up to 20 times a day, 24 hours a day. You couldn't even keep water down. I lost 5 kilos. I don't know how much that is in pounds. I'll put it on the screen if I remember. I lost 5 pounds by the time five kilos by the time I was 16 weeks pregnant. So by the time I was 4 months pregnant, I'd lost over 5% of my body weight due to the vomiting and the sickness. There's just been so much going on with it, and it's quite a cruel condition because it's very isolating. There was some days where I didn't even leave the upstairs of the house where our bathroom is, let alone leave the house. Like, just wasn't possible. And we'd try and go for a walk and I would literally just vomit from one end of the field to the other. And it's so embarrassing as well, like vomiting in public, and just the sheer exhaustion from it, because you're not sleeping, you're not eating, you can't keep drink down. And then you have to kind of prove to a lot of the medical profession that you are actually ill and you're not making it up and it's not in your head, and it's a lot. I also got really bad motion sickness with it. So if I was in the car, that would trigger a huge amount of sickness. And then like crocheting and knitting would cause me to vomit. And that was the hardest bit of it all, because people would be like, well, you just stay home and rest. But I couldn't even bear to have like the light on. I didn't want the room to be warm. I didn't want to smell anything. I couldn't move, because even just moving my head, I would vomit. Like, you just can't comprehend it unless you've been through it or seen someone go through it. And I couldn't crochet or knit because the movement would make me sick. So it meant from October until like late December, I wasn't knitting or crocheting. And for somebody who knits and crochets for their living, that's not ideal. And so for now, everything is kind of on pause. I've got loads and loads of plans for the HGDEC hub. I've got loads of workbooks that I want to do. I've got planners. I've got so many different things, as well as loads of patterns that I want to put out. I think I've got like 10 workbooks drafted. So at least I know what I want it to be about. I've probably got a rough idea of the content. I might have even started writing some of the contents. I think there's 4 or 5 different planners. There's also some other resources on top of that. And then in terms of patterns, I've got a list, and there is about 26 patterns on there where I've got like ideas, or I've started bits and pieces. It hasn't been possible, and I found that really, really frustrating, because I absolutely love my job. I love what I do, and not being able to do it, I felt like I lost a big part of my identity. Whereas now I'm just choosing to see it that I needed to put things on pause, and I'm using this time to work on baby tailor projects and using that to really work on building loads of different techniques. So I'm learning so many different cast-ons and bind-offs and steeking and different methods of construction, and they're all in these tiny weeny little designs, little patterns, little jumpers and whatnot, so they don't take much time to make. Because I'm following somebody else's pattern, I don't have to use a lot of my brain power, because some days when I've had 2 hours sleep, you don't have the brain space to then be grading your own pattern, but you can follow somebody else's pattern. So yeah, everything's on pause, and I've made my peace with that, and once baby's here and we get into a routine, I will be returning to HGDC, and I'll make that work in the time that I've got. And there's a lot of upcoming projects as soon as I'm able to do so. I have been getting little bits done, don't get me wrong, but like, for example, last week I went for a routine checkup and thought I'd be there like an hour, and I ended up being admitted, and then I was there over 24 hours. I think it was like 30 something hours later I finally got home. And that then doesn't just then take those 2 days that you're there, because you don't get much rest in hospital. It had messed my sleep schedule up. There's also like the emotional side of it, because there's quite a lot that goes on basically, and it can feel quite traumatic and quite heavy. So I've got all that to deal with and process and shake off when I get home. And then it's like usually the next day is a write off, because I need to like rest, sort myself out, like have a proper shower, wash my hair, sort out whatever needs sorting out. And then it gets to Thursday and I'm just starting to get back on my feet. And then Friday rolls around, and before you know it, it's the weekend. I try and take the weekends off to spend with Brad. So some of these appointments come along and completely derail my week. And also I went through a phase of having weekly blood tests to check my liver function, because my liver has been impacted by the sickness. And I would go and have the blood test on the Monday, and then I'd get a call on the Wednesday, you need to come in, you need more blood tests, we need to do this, we need to do that, and that's your week gone. So it's really, really hard to make plans, because then when you're in a hospital bed, it's not like I'm going to sit there and work. I can't crochet if I've got cannulas in my arm, because I can't bend my arm, and I'm not going to take my Mac and try and work when I'm supposed to be resting and focusing on health. So a lot of frustration, but I've made a lot of peace with it, and I can't wait to show you the things that I've been brewing. I also, because I've had to step back, it's really given me a lot of time to really think about the direction that I'm going in, and to turn down projects that don't necessarily accord with what I want and my goals. So that has also been another blessing. Last two questions. One of the questions is, what is my favourite hair stuff? My favourite thing to put in my hair is just plain water. So I've got a spray bottle, spray it with water, and it helps to keep my curls nourished. Right now my hair really needs a wash, so don't want to be drawing attention to it, but whatever. This is my favourite product to use. I discovered it about a month ago. It's Garnier and it's hair food. The ultimate blend. I really like this one. It's the aloe vera and coconut. You can either put it in as a conditioner and wash it out, you can put it in as a mask and again wash it out, but like you leave it in for maybe like 10-20 minutes, or you put it in as a leave-in, and I do a combination of them all. So I tend to put it in as a mask, and then like I might wrap my hair in like a towel or something to keep it warm so it gets like a deeper treatment. And then whenever I've washed it, and then throughout the week, I put this in it, and then I top it up with coconut oil. I've tried a couple of the other flavours. It's not a flavour because you don't eat it, but they've got different variations, different... What is it? Flavours? Whatever. Different types of this. There's a papaya and something one. The only one I'm not keen on is banana, because I just feel like when you put it in your hair after a couple of days, your hair smells like overripe banana. Blah. I've tried quite a few products and I have allergies, so I can't have anything with nuts in. So that's a little bit of a minefield when it comes to black hair care. And that's something that I found. You can get it easily in supermarkets, so I don't have to go to a particular shop, because that can be another issue. Not so much now, but definitely like 10 years ago, you couldn't get black hair stuff in normal shops with white people hair stuff. Whereas now you can get certain brands, but this is in like every supermarket. So it's easy enough for me to say to Brad, can you get me some of this? And you not have to go like out of his way to get it. And it's quite affordable. It lasts a long time and my hair loves it. And my hair's been growing really, really well since I have been pregnant. I had to do a really big chop back in November because COVID and sickness from pregnancy had really impacted it. So that was quite hard to do. I chopped off about 3 inches, maybe a bit more. But then I've been using the Garnier stuff and I chopped it and it was like sitting on my shoulders and now it's all the way down here. Even with the sickness, it's growing really, really well. And then the last question, which I thought was a cute one to end on, are you happy? Yes, yes, I am happy. Happiness is an emotion, so they come and go. You can't be happy 24/7, just like you can't be angry 24/7 and you don't want to be sad 24/7. But the majority of the time, I am happy. There's been a lot going on and I've felt a whole cocktail of things, from like frustration to just despair. Like, there's been a lot, but overall I'm so happy with my life. I have always wanted a family. Throughout my 20s, I was very career focused. I wanted to have certain things in place. I wanted money in the bank. I wanted my own home. I wanted to be married. And not just to anyone. I wanted it to be like my best friend, love of my life. I knew exactly what I wanted in a husband. And I got to 29 and I still hadn't found that, and I'd kind of just made peace with maybe that won't happen for me. And then I met Brad and here we are. By the time baby arrives, baby's actually due like 3 years to the day that Brad and I started talking. So I feel incredibly grateful and incredibly blessed for the life that I've got. We have our own home. We have a roof over our head. We have our own safe place to sleep. We have heating. We have food in the cupboard. We've got money in the bank to pay bills. And I've got a garden that I can spend time in and that I can grow all of my favourite things there. We have Albie, which is our dog. And I have a lot of joy in walking him. And I'm looking forward to getting back to that. And he's just a huge comfort and a great source of company for me, especially the last 8 months of being at home. And I'm just so grateful for our home. If we didn't have it and the last 8 months had been the way it had been, it would have been even harder, because yeah, this has just been where I've spent every minute of every day, unless I've been in hospital. And there's no place like home, and home to me is Brad and Albie and that security. And I've got loads of plans for HGDC, and I'm really looking forward to doing all of them. And also I have my baby on the way, and baby is happy and healthy and strong, and we've got this far and we don't have that far left to go. So yeah, I am happy, and I'm really grateful for all the support that I've had from my tribe, from church, family, friends, and Brad, because without Brad, I wouldn't have got through this, but without Brad, I wouldn't be pregnant. So yeah, I am so happy. Like, it's a weird one because there is so much going on, but I am happy. Thank you for asking that. And that's all of the questions. So if you left a question, thank you so much. Thank you for taking the time to watch this. I want to do this really regularly now. So if you have a question for me, if watching this has given you, you want to know something, or you just have a random question, please leave it below, because I want to do these more regularly, and they'll be a little bit shorter next time. I'm probably only going to pick like 3 or 4 questions, and I'm going to answer them. And in terms of granny squares, let me quickly show you the ones I've made. So I made 2 centers in green, and then said, actually, let me put the second rounds on. So 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 I've put together, and all of the ends, which I know some of you hate, I will get them done. Maybe even I'll start weaving them in on the next question and answer. So leave your questions below, and I will pick the best 3 or 4 and answer them next time. Thank you for watching, tribe. Take care. Bye. Baby's trampling on my guts. Excuse me. It kind of hurts. We need to coexist in this space, child. Baby.